Until now, starting in about 2004, we've had three molecules to treat most neovascular diseases or vascular diseases such as Avastin, bevacizumab, and ranibizumab. Avastin, aflibercept, and ranibizumab. And all three of them work exactly by the same mechanism of action, which is inhibition of VEGF. And as we know from 15 years of clinical trials, we have a ceiling effect with these drugs that really is not that different. There might be some small differences as seen in the Cat and Ivan trial and other trials. But what we know about these diseases also is that they're multifactorial, multi-mechanistic diseases, and we're only attacking one mechanism of action with the anti-VEGF drugs. Faricimab is the first novel bispecific antibody designed by Roche. This molecule has two Fab arms. One binds VEGF-A, the other binds Ang-2. Ang-2, we know now, is a modulator of angiogenesis, and it acts in the body by inhibiting Ang-1. Think of Ang-1 as a good guy. It protects vascular homeostasis, maintains stable cellular vasculature. Ang-2 is upregulated in CRVO, DME, AMD, and it inhibits the effect, the protective effect of Ang-1 by blocking Ti-2, the tyrosine kinase receptor. So now this increases cell permeability, destabilization. It also upregulates VEGF-A. And we know VEGF-A, of course, promotes, sprouting of new blood vessels and endothelial destabilization. So coming back to faricimab, we have a molecule with one arm blocking Ang-2, the other arm blocking VEGF-A, and a very unique Fc receptor, Fc function that does not have any effector function, but increases systemic clearance by which decreasing the inflammatory potential of the molecule. What's also unique about it is that it can bind either VEGF-A or Ang-2 without steric hindrance of one of the arms blocking the other arm's ability to bind the molecule. And it does so with very high specificity and potency. This molecule has shown very good results in the phase 1 and the phase 2 studies in BOULEVARD. Faricimab-treated patients showed a statistically significant gain over 0.3 milligram ranibizumab. What is even more interesting is in the off-treatment portion of the study, the patients were treated every 4 weeks up to week 20. Starting week 24, they were observed every 4 weeks up to week 36, with treatment allowed if they met pre-specified disease criteria of lack of durability, which means if the patient lost more than 5 letters of vision or gained more than 50 microns of central subfield thickness. In the off-treatment phase, the 0.6 milligram arm and the 1.5 milligram arm showed increased durability both in the previously treated patients and the treatment naive patients, showing a durability effect of a significant proportion more patients requiring less rescue in both those arms. That is something unique. I mean, we have a lot of approaches right now to the dual mechanism approach. But where we are up against in treating all these diseases is we've reached a ceiling effect with what we have. We can try for higher efficacy, but that is also limited by the pathology of the disease and the damage and the chronicity caused by the disease. Or we can go for durability. And very simply, for example, in my patient population, my diabetic macular edema patients, over 60% of them are still working, okay? The ability to come every month or even every 6 weeks or every 8 weeks for injections is very limited and over a what period of time. So if you can come up with a molecule that reduces patient treatment burden, such as faricimab, I think that is one of the many, many approaches that we're all going to see in the future trying to target this disease by more than just the anti-VEGF-A approach.